Steve, and check www.rctv.org for more information and for replay times. And we have a continued notice of intent hearing for 270-0680-1260-1264 Main Street, map 45, lot 104 and 106, Massachusetts Equity Investments, LLC.
Thank you. For the record, my name is John Tucker, Wayne Sparge Engineering. This last time we're here, we had, I think it's maybe two sidewalks, at least. And then we...
Yes, we did.
Subsequent, from the other sidewalks, we have revised the plans. We did submit plans. Did you hear those all? Did they get those?
I can do it. You can do it.
So I know from the last sidewalk, someone would like to move, so we went through and actually, it's shown this plan here. First location for letting flags, and we did the line, so it's on the plan you're getting here. So I'll go through the changes to the plan. We're still proposing the roadway, the five lots, but with some modifications now. I showed the light of green here, and it's on your plan. This is the new wetland line location. I show it's kind of like brown.
The old one was?
This is the old one.
Okay.
How you do second opening steps?
Sure.
You can see it's going to be on sheets. Sheet 2, existing condition plan. We show the new line location on there, it's in a heavier line. And we show the old line. And I'll go through. So what we're signing in the back here, the flag A3 has been replaced with A3A back here. This is off the property. Flag A7 is connected directly to flag A9. We skipped A8. This is what we talk about in the field. Flag A13A has been added. A13 was missing, so we replaced A13A. And flag out front here, towards Main Street, flag A14A and flag A17A have been added. The new connection is from A14 to A14A to A17A to 19 up front. So this is the biggest change this area here. You can see what bumps out in here. Then we went back and redid the buffer zone, the CMD line, 25 foot, 25 foot no fill line buffer here. And those are modifications to the plan. Then we went back and revised, pretty much affected these two, us, 4 and 5. So on lot 4, we twisted the house, pulled the 4 a little bit, and moved the patio back here. And the retaining wall is about 3 to 4 feet high. It's about 2 feet inside, outside the 35-foot build area. So this lot's been changed. Just the location configuration of the house itself. Here on lot 5, what we did too, the addition's been cut back. We're about 9 feet from the edge of the house to the wall, and 10 feet away from the mill build. We also pulled back the driveway here, and the infiltration at the end of the driveway. It's all been pulled forward, facing the new 35-foot no build. The other change we made to the plan, we have reduced the width of the paved area from 30 feet here to 26 feet. We reduced the pavement area on the side, it's more green, but we kept the cul-de-sac the same for fire access purposes. This radius is still we access. Turn around by fire truck. But again, this has changed here in the radius is the same in the front, but just a little less taken possible. So in doing so, we have no green area between the sidewalk and the green area. We did some additional test holes on the site, one back here and one in the front infiltration. DEP requested that. They also requested mounting calculations, which we submitted to you. And those were basically to find out if there's any breakout in the infiltration pond, the detention pond. We provide those calves, there's no breakout. We sent the same information you have to DEP. So they're getting information they requested here and there, test hole data and the anomaly calculations. Let's see. We're still, the road name actually became, we're still calling it 1260 Main Street. Now today, the new name approved by the town is Veterans Way. It doesn't reflect in the plan, but that's the changes we made. We're making today, unfortunately, two in time for the changes. And the last thing, easement language, we still, the attorney's still working on the easement language on it at this time. We had some samples we're working on, but it just didn't happen right tonight. So I spoke to him, and we want to know if we can add that as a condition prior to any construction, that documents regarding the easement and the trail be provided to the commission before they can do any site work. Or, because he's close to it, I know we'd have it by the, within, if you close tonight, by the time you issue your conditions, we would have that language to you. So that's kind of what we're asking for. So that's, those are changes right there. It's in the letter I sent to you. If you have any answer any questions, we have this time.
I'm noticing, I have a big plan, a big set, the previous plan, on lot four. The new location, I see how you've pushed the retaining wall back and the structure fits. Did you add a walkout? Is, what's that little white thing at?
That'd be a patio or a deck.
Right. And they were on the previous one.
I believe so, yeah. I think that we were asked to show those in that.
Yeah, and then I noticed another one up on lot three.
Yeah, I added that also because we didn't show them, so we put that on that.
I just can't see from here. See, so is the retaining wall still basically on the 35 foot line?
Yeah, but it's moved
back.
It's back
to
the new 35 foot.
The other thing I noticed from this is the path out to Kirchin Woods on this is.
It's different, yeah.
Yeah, it's very
sinuous. The reason being is that, well, if we do this path here, we said we might cut some trees down, so why don't we make it so in the field and with the trail committee and maybe Chuck up there to try to save the bigger trees and not stake it out and start cutting. Let's kind of work with the terrain here and grades. That's kind of why we show it differently in two different plans. We want to kind of leave it open at this point.
Okay.
So I just to clarify, so is how it's shown on here actually an opening that would work without cutting, or is it just kind of a general?
It's
going to
be a field decision. We didn't.
Okay.
Well, I think the new plan, this plan, I showed right before we looked at trees. We looked at trees up there, so that's why I kind of twisted the term. I still think in the two field decision.
Chuck, are there any other things that need to get resolved with engineering and or DEP, or is that all set?
They just sent out mounting calculations. I'm not sure.
Yeah, there are
DEPs in the audience. I mean, engineering's in the audience. If you want to ask them, I'm not sure they had a chance to review this. I had a couple of questions about whether the retaining wall has a fence on top of it, or where was that left?
Yeah, I think we talked about it last time. We were willing to put a post and rail fence or something on top of the retaining wall. It was probably last meeting. I didn't show it here, but if it's part of the condition, that's fine.
Question about relative to the wall.
Yeah.
And I think it was your first presentation meeting about the wall when you talked about the wall. And I believe at that time you said that the wall was intended to be a barrier for those people that were living in those lots. So do not go, do not pass, do not plant, do not.
Right. Well, somewhat, but I think it's a 25 foot.
Right.
Is the key. Our wall is a 35 foot.
Right.
And what we are showing here, for your question, we're showing the markers too.
Yep.
Here it would be the stone on bounds with the cards on top, but I guess you provide.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, was that your question or?
I kind of was going to, is that going to be a written restriction to those lots?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think we'll write it, it's part of the town bylaws, that they can't go beyond that. For instance, structure, I guess technically they could go in here and mow it on the other side of the wall, because it, as long as they're outside the 25-foot.
Right.
But this kind of deters them from someone going down there, I believe.
I know it's a visual and a practical barrier. I didn't know whether there was gonna be a deed restriction barrier to that, and.
I mean, we could probably put it in a deed restriction, no work, within the 25-foot ZMD zone. We could do that, but I mean, the markers themselves, kind of self-explanatory. Will it follow it? You know, I don't know.
Were there other items?
Yeah, I think the fence that you're putting up there, I was thinking something more substantial. I mean, I guess that fence is okay. There are no gates in it?
Well, I don't show. I would probably put a gate in there. I mean, if it's 4 feet off the ground, probably not.
Yeah, I don't think you want a gate on.
So it's blowing air. You know, I don't think we'd have a gate, maybe.
The reason for the fence is to just prevent people from dumping in and over the fence.
Mm-hmm.
So if there's a retaining wall, that may happen. I'm not sure. We have a lot of luck with fences, but that doesn't. So that just prevent that from happening. But a post and rail fence isn't much of a deterrent.
Yeah. We've seen both cases. If you put a solid fence up, they'll dump it over, and then you can't see it. It's an open fence. Sometimes, we have a site in Wilmington, well, they didn't dump it over because they could see where they're dumping. You kind of run that. We had talked about putting a fence on top. We're agreeable to that.
Have we ever done a... I don't know what we did on 364 Lowell Street, but just a sign in the back of the yard that says nothing. So that it's clear, you put it on the fence or whatever, on the customer out fence, or I see a point about it.
If they have to sit and look at it, they're less likely to do it.
Well, I mean, it's a reminder.
Yeah, I don't know.
But, I think you have put requirements, no dumping. Have you put posts before on the fence itself?
I think at Lowell Street, it's going to be a separate fence. Just a simple little sign that says, this is a protected habitat, no dumping.
And pilot conditions, it's fine.
I think that makes sense. I think that's a good idea. That's a concern, and...
Because that's what we're trying to prevent. Putting up a big expensive fence that someone might not like and want to take down or whatever doesn't necessarily solve our problem. And then the contractors see it, and they realize they're not supposed to do it if the homeowner's not home, and I think that'd be it. You okay with that?
I'm fine with that. Post and rail fence and three or four signs maybe every... 20, 30 feet, just, not monster signs, maybe 12 by 12, restricted area, no dumping of leaves or debris or branches, something like that.
Yep.
Well, one for each lot.
Yeah.
That's right. We'll have the marks too, the marks on top.
Any other questions from the commission members? Any questions from the community? So is everything all set with this, or do they still need have some review?
So it sounds like, we just got these documents. We haven't received the language from the lawyer yet. I think it's in a good spot. I think we're in a position where we could start to prepare something for the an order of conditions, but I don't know that I'm ready to necessarily make a motion to close. I would prefer have it continued and still get it ready, but I would like to have an opportunity to review the language and the, if we close it, all of a sudden the clock starts ticking and we start to have issues.
John, did you say that the language wouldn't be ready for what, they're still working on that?
I spoke to him the other day, he was working on it, and he was going to try and fish it tonight, he said he would not be able to fish it.
Okay.
So he said, well, maybe we can ask for as part of condition that no work prior to the start of any work, this had to be submitted and accepted by the board. He wanted to put that in condition.
Mm-hmm.
And so they really couldn't do anything until you guys accepted it. So that's I know I'm kind of, but his opinion is that we could just wait another month then before we close this out.
Chuck, could we leave it open, and if all the ducks in a row, could we close an issue at the next meeting? Is that possible?
Yeah. So what we've done before is Chuck will prepare it as if we're gonna have everything, as if we're gonna get the last documents, and then we're all in agreement. But it leaves the opportunity for us to still have discussion next time if there is an issue or if something.
Yeah, anyone asked, they know to do that.
Yeah.
If we're not, then.
Hey, well, Ryan, did you look at this? No?
No.
Okay, so we'll need input from Ryan and a couple other things.
The comments I have about this, I have no problem, you know, closing this and preparing the order of conditions, because let's face it, that trail is on a potential easement for future road anyway, so. That's not a place that's gonna, anything's gonna be built as part of this development, so that really shouldn't hold up.
Well, I think there's a couple other loose ends too, Dave, that's why, it's not just that.
Such as?
The calcs, right, we'd like to have Ryan look at and verify the calculations on the drainage.
Yep.
And sign language, French language, we can put in there.
If we get everything as it's indicated, it's still gonna, the timeline is still the same.
Yeah.
So do I hear a motion to continue?
So I make a motion to continue.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Chuck, the next item is Strawberry Hill Lane.
Do I just have like more copies of this?
Yeah, you do.
Yeah, this is. It is, isn't it?
Did you get plans today?
I did get plans today.
All right, and so it's similarly, we haven't had very much time. I haven't seen them. So they were on the agenda at 7:10, but
so
it was continued.
Yeah, we can open the hearing and continue it to
April 26th.
Tonight, if he comes in. Or you can, I mean, that's going to at least give him a chance in case something happens.
So if we all right.
Continue it to
the last agenda item.
Yeah, you could say 8:10 if Jack comes in.
All right, let's do that.
We can talk about it then.
Do you have to open it?
Yes. This is a continued notice of intent hearing for 270-0681 14 Strawberry Hill Lane, map 7, lot 193, Moynihan. Seeing that it is past 7:10, we are going to continue. Well, we can hold a hearing after maybe 8:00, 8:10.
I make a motion to continue till 8:10.
Do I have a second? All those in favor? Okay.
Yeah.
2 minutes over, but 7:20. We have a. Is this a notice of, no, this is a,
yeah, it's under the,
existing. Existing.
Maintenance
permit.
Yep.
And it's 270-0638 Grove Street near number 283. And we have Reading DPW Engineering Department here.
Grove Street.
Oh,
okay. Do you have it?
I think I do.
Get my stuff out.
first of all, town engineer, just presenting Grove Street. This will be underneath our order, existing order of conditions for both drainage and water and sewer blanket order of conditions that were issued. So this is just a notification to the board, to the commission here. Briefly going over it, it's two, I guess we can go over it as two separate projects, but it will be contracted as one. We have an existing water main that will be replaced in kind with a 12-inch ductile line, which we've been having numerous water main breaks in that section. So that is the water main replacement that's going through there. And then also, we're fixing some drainage issues that we do have out there currently and alleviating some erosion problems that we also have out there currently. And that's with the addition of two double basins up here, catching most of this flow that comes down here and only ends up in this one basin that we have down there. So we're just intercepting halfway up the hill with the double catch basin, which will be leaching basins if we can get them in, as well as a double catch basin down here at this driveway as well. We took some input from one of the neighbors down here that does flood out with some of the surface water, so that's why we're adding this in. And we're lowering this grade by an inch, just as much as we can get with the culvert crossing. So all the work will be performed within the right of way, and every catch basin, which is only the one down at the bottom and a couple of catch basins up there, Meadowbrook Golf Course will have silt sacks in them. We will be placing silt fence roughly along this area in here to protect you know, the ditch area that we have in this area here, although we don't expect anything to go in that area, it is super elevated to the other way. And we will also be discharging any groundwater into a settling basin or dirt bag combination and dewatering that way when we do encounter any groundwater crossing underneath the culvert. Pretty straightforward project for us. It's just a notification of what we're going to be doing.
Ryan, you said erosion control?
It's like wattles, straw wattles.
No, I thought you meant you were fixing erosion issues that you've been having.
So we do. We have, because of some of the velocities that we start picking up down in this area here.
Yep.
We do have berm out there now. We will be replacing with berm when we repave the road. When we're intercepting the flow that comes down here, so we're not picking up high velocities, which are flooding out some of these driveways.
Okay.
We're basically, no flow is being added to the culvert, we're just intercepting it higher up.
Do you have, I guess my question is, are there areas where you're going to be fixing areas where things have been washed out in the past?
So after the project is done, the road will be paved completely. And when we repave the road, it is the intent to put back all of the asphalt berm that was there. So any of that that was damaged over the years from plow damage, everything will be replaced.
We took a site visit out there, and there were two neighbors that did come out. And if you look up the hill towards, is it Franklin? Franklin comes in. You can see it coming down like this. But as you get closer to the bottom where the main catch basin is, it looks like the road actually tilts or crowns to the east. Is that true?
It is. It's all super elevated back to that one basin down in the low end.
That's so is that the source of the flooding down there, as well as the parking at Meadowbrook?
No. It's super elevated by design. Otherwise, everything would push out to the other end where there is no basin. And majority of the surface runoff that does come down this street only ends up to that one basin. So that's primarily the issue. By putting the double basin halfway or maybe a little further down the hill, we're intercepting it well before it gets to those trouble areas, and we're only leaving a small portion of surface runoff that is going to that basin, which will be a double basin as well.
I have another couple questions. They're not... I didn't generate these questions. Is there anything such as a green infrastructure to infiltrate in this area?
So we are proposing leaching catch basins, which provide us treatment and also recharge.
Okay, so you do have a leaching catch
basin. Yeah, we're our intent is to put in at least two new leaching catch basins on the midpoint of the hill, and when we evaluate down at the bottom, we'll see if we can also get a leaching catch basin.
What would prevent that, Ryan? Ledge?
No. What would prevent that would be if we have a really high groundwater. At that point,
doesn't matter.
It's counterproductive
yeah.
what we're doing. But if we can fit it in, we will.
Okay.
That's the intent.
Any other questions from the commission?
I have a question, and it was something that was generated by one of the neighbors and claimed that there was not enough area in the outfall with that 36-inch concrete pipe that's there. And we walked up back to the where that pipe goes underground to the north of number 283, right about where, you know, in the back. I think you can see it. There's a little line that is
mm-hmm.
shown there. The velocity of the water that's going in that end of the pipe is significantly greater than that coming out of the pipe on the other side of Grove Street.
During heavy rain events, and we have studied this, during heavy rain events, there is a restriction in that culvert. Again, we're not presenting a culvert replacement project at this time. This is part of a phased solution to issues that are out there. There's also in the downstream end of the vent wall, where the outfall is, there's probably about 150 feet of sediment that has built up over the years.
Right.
So there's a restriction there as well. The intent is that we will be moving forward at some point when funding is available to tackle each of those separately, one as a dredging project and another if we alleviate a lot of the issues, then we will re-look at the culvert at that point.
Is that culvert from where it goes underground to the daylight end of it on the other side of Grove Street, has that been evaluated or televised? Because it would seem, just from my observation the other day, there wasn't a heavy rain period. It was bright and sunny, and the brook that runs down beside the golf course, you know, had a significant flow, and it was basically stagnant coming out the daylight end on the other side of Grove Street.
So on the outlet side, the bottom of the ditch is higher than the outfall. I don't know if you noticed that, but that's the sediment buildup that's on that, and that would put
right.
a restriction. That's something that we're going to be looking at further down the road to dredge, but that's a separate filing. Number two, we periodically go through there in high velocity, that line, to make sure it's clean. We can go back in there and check it again.
Yeah.
There may be an obstruction in there from the last time we cleaned it out. So we can go in there in high velocity and clean it out.
Ryan, if you could just enlighten me, I think I've heard from Chuck that the process as it goes with this permit is pretty well, but you're currently, you've put this out to bid. Do you have a contractor on board?
Nope, it has not gone out to bid yet.
Okay.
What's
the communicate, like, when do we know it's going to start and when things are going to occur?
So we're anticipating for a bid opening mid-May.
Mm-hmm.
I will be in communication with Chuck, as fortunately we work in the same building, so we get notification. Prior to that, we can have if Chuck or the commission would like to have a meeting or a sidewalk, that's fine to go over. We'll be put out for erosion control. But there will be notification prior to any construction, and also a pre-construction meeting if you know, that is what to do. That's fine. We usually have our own pre-construction meeting.
Yep.
If you'd like to have one out in the field prior, that's fine as well.
What type of pre-construction meeting do we have for this? It's just engineering department or?
Generally, we've met and gone over the start of the project to make sure that you're happy with the erosion setup and the wattles and where they're placed.
Right, I was just wondering if it was gonna be something like a DRT or the end of the police have to be there and discuss.
No.
Any more questions for the commission or Chuck? Any questions from the?
I do have a question.
Okay.
Can you just go back and tell me, I understand that you're gonna put down, is it three or two definitely leaching catch basins? And then two more if the groundwater will allow?
No, no. So altogether, there's three catch basin, new catch basin, well, I shouldn't say that. There's two new catch basin and a replacement of one. The intent is that these will go in as catch basins, and we should be able to get those in since we're in good condition. If we do find that we are sitting on a ledge pocket, that would enter us to that. I don't expect that here. However, down here, groundwater will be prevailing back down those.
And it's just one?
It's just, yeah, so there's a replacement of one and two new basins, that's correct.
That's what I needed.
And we are intending to put in leaching basins where we can, that's correct.
Any questions from the community? Chuck, well, this is an existing order conditions. Do we need to make any motion or is this just a hearing?
I think we'd make a motion to approve this project as it was presented, and that'll be all we needed.
Make a motion to approve as presented to us?
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you very much.
Thanks, Brian.
Thank you.
I think you're on for the next one.
I am, I'm on again.
Let's keep on going.
And this is 7:30, request for determination of applicability for 2017-2 roadway maintenance project throughout the town. And we're on.
I'll just give a brief description of what this is, and then Chris Cole can go through the descriptions of what we do.
Can I do the streets first or just the map?
Yeah, why don't you just go to the map there? So this is for an RDA for our annual, well, one of our annual paving. We'll be back again this year. We do this every year, and basically we're flagging out areas that fall within the buffers, but we're also showing here that, and correct me if I'm wrong, Chris, but anywhere that touches 200 feet around those areas, and that's where we're placing all of our erosion control and sediment control measures. Again, there's a few different methods of what we do here. There's just a stated overlay, there's a milling overlay, and I think red is reclaim.
Yes.
And the difference between those three processes are a reclaim would be pulverizing the whole entire road until you're down to bare gravel, grading, and then coming back and doing binder and top coat of pavement. On a milling overlay, you would basically be milling down about an inch and a half and leaving the paved surface.
Yeah.
So you really have no exposed gravel at that point. It's just the old milled asphalt surface, which is milled and then swept. So you don't really have erosion on those. And then we pave. And then the next would be, and I don't know if we just have regular overlay.
Yes, we do.
And what we do is just a regular overlay, we just overlay the road. So we don't touch it, it's just, it stays in its original condition, and we just overlay the road. So there's no erosion on that one. The biggest one that you'd have would be a reclaim, where you'd have that gravel exposed for a period of time.
So, I take it you've done these in the past?
Yes.
We've seen, you've come before us before with these, and Chuck, everything
Chris,
seems to go well.
How many have we done?
We've done pretty much one of these every single year for, you know, as long as I've been working here for the town, and pretty much, you know, it's pretty straightforward. You know, we'll Chuck and I will just go out, look at all these different locations that are in your jurisdiction, and you know, we'll take a look at, see what Chuck thinks we need erosion control, and you know, as Brian would say, anywhere that a road falls within that pink area, which is within 200 feet of a resource area, we will be putting the silt sacks and the catch basins, including guttering and protection, you know, for like a storm water or something like that. But at a minimum, all catch basins will have the filter fabric placed in them. It's always going very smoothly, you know, never been an issue before with anything, so.
I do remember that discussion about the storm drains and how they need to be dismantled and rebuilt.
Correct.
And the discussion at the last meeting when we went over roads was people were worried about, commission was worried about things falling in.
Mm-hmm.
And if there would be any cleaning of those catch basins at the end.
I will tell you, debris does fall in when they're rebuilding the frame and grates. So when they're pulling them off, it's almost impossible to keep things from falling in. When they do fall in, they clean them out. They clean out all the bricks. We also go through prior to the close of the job, as we check every single structure as well. So they clean them at that point as well. But generally, when something falls in, it's cleaned up immediately when they're there, because that's the easiest time for them to clean it. The frames, the frame and grate is not dead.
That you're not talking with with a vac truck or anything like that.
We have had cases where
as needed,
correct. We have had cases where you might have a plate that shifts during the grading portion, and you will have gravel fall in. It is vacked out immediately. Usually that happens on our sewer system, and we can't afford that to back up. So
some
sucked up immediately.
Some of the concern is when you're rebuilding those, it's done with mortar, right? You're gonna use mortar in this.
It's done with a Portland cement that doesn't react with salt.
So if a lump of that falls into the catch basin,
mm-hmm.
and gets dispersed into the stream, it's going to be problems with the fish. So keep an eye out for that and try to clean that up. The only other thing that came up over the course of 5 years was the tree row, and that was cut into and reseeded.
Okay.
So we have planned where we weren't going to wait till the end of the project in the summer to do that. It's just done on, I don't remember how often is that done in this project?
Well, there is language in the contract now since that discussion that weather permitting requires the contractor to loom and seed within 2 weeks after the final pavement of the road occurs.
And when do you anticipate doing this work?
This project will also be bid mid-May, and construction will start as soon as we can after that. It's only 12 streets. What we do is 16 streets, one of them being Salem Street. So the construction period will be a little bit longer than what we actually do when we do 26 streets. And then the intensive, you'll see us again, we'll come back probably mid-summer with another list of roads for the late summer fall.
Any other questions from commission members?
Nope.
Have we made motions to, what?
Just this, Albert.
Oh yeah, sorry. Any questions from the community? Hearing none.
I make a motion to approve as presented.
Second.
Well, this is a request for determination.
This is an RDA?
Yeah.
This doesn't fall under the same?
No, it sounds like that they've, each time they do this, they come in with an RDA. So would you make a motion to?
So I make a motion to issue a negative determination.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
So Chuck, do you put in conditions?
We do. In the general conditions we discussed tonight, are there any other conditions you'd like? Notification? I mean, it's been,
when you get
this
notified,
project coming before us for 5 years, we've gotten a lot of bugs out of the system.
Yep.
It runs pretty well.
I'm fine with that.
Do we have a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ryan.
Thank you.
Thanks, Chris.
Okay, we have $7.40, a notice of intent. We don't have a full DEP number. It's for 45 Causeway Road, map 25, lot 57, Reading Municipal Light Department.
And the public hearing is now open and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act, Mass General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. The hearing will be conducted in the following manner. Applicant presents proposal. Commission will receive reports from administrator, technical advisors. Commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and the public will be given an opportunity. And any questions from the public is directed to the chair. And when you do, give your name and address. At this time, I'd like to introduce members of the Conservation Commission, starting on my right.
David Pinnett.
Al Pouliard.
Harry Curtis.
Rebecca Long, the chair.
Michael Flynn.
Chuck Tirani, Conservation Administrator.
And the applicant.
Matt Brown, Reading Light Department, Assistant Light Department. Joe Jamal, Cushing Jamal, and we are Reading Light Environmental Consultant. And should I?
Yes, you should.
What Reading Light is intending to do or is proposing is to install a substitute or a new utility pole for a failed utility pole in the area of their station 4, which is on Causeway Road. And the documents that we submitted to you, there is a figure in there that has some other information on it than this one up here. The area of the new pole is approximately right here. The existing pole and the new pole. The existing pole and the this is north on this map. And the plan is to install the new pole approximately 7 feet to the west of the existing pole, which puts you basically right on the wetlands line. Or, to the best we can figure, literally a foot within the buffer zone. The way that the method of installation is with a truck-mounted auger rig. It's about a 2 foot diameter auger down 9 to 12 feet. And it's likely that a sonotube would be placed in that hole, and within that tube, the new utility pole would be placed. Reading Light's trucks would enter the site from West Street and proceed along, there's a gravel road here, and then enter to get to this location by driving along the southern side of this fence line here. When they do the work, there will be sedimentation controls by way of wattles that will be placed in the work area. And there will be mats on which the trucks will be placed.
I only have one question. Is the auger hole where the new pole is going in, where the existing pole is there standing water there, or is it pretty dry, or I didn't get out there.
Check it out.
Yeah, we were out there. It was standing water, and it was moist coming down this area here where it says 1C, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then from 6 to 21, it was more standing water, but not very wide, maybe 5 feet wide.
Yeah.
Water.
Right where the pole.
It kind of very similar to what you see right here, except from 5 to 2 or to 1, there wasn't much standing water. I was walking out in that area.
I have some observations. Originally, I think you had mentioned that wasn't going to be further into the wetland when we were out there, because it wasn't 7 feet. Was it a little bit further?
We were going towards Route 93, which is to the west. 7 feet to the west.
Right.
So you had said 7 feet, because when I remember when you said that, it looked like it was going to be right in the wetland.
That is not the intent.
Okay, that's good.
You may have or I may have miscommunicated. The reason we're moving one pole is because we're working on what's called the 503 line. That's what we're proposing work on this time around with two failed poles, with the anticipation of replacing poles on the other line to meet the NEC National Electric Safety Code. We have one structure that's actually too close to the grounded steel, and it's 115 kV. So when the engineers did their drawings, they required us to move one pole 7 feet with the intent of the other pole getting moved out away from the steel structure. And that's where it enters the station, so they have all the down guy wires to hold the train of the pole. And if they don't move the pole 7 feet, you're going to have basically a ground going into a 115 line, which can't happen. So that was why they are moving the pole from this location.
So when I look at it, it does line up with the pole to the south of it. So, we had talked about that, because when you were out there, this pole was here and this one was a little bit over this way.
To not create a corner, which would require guy wires. More augering in the ground and anchor blades and guy wires and that sort of thing.
But I also remember you saying that further up there's another pole closer to the road. And does that line up with that one as
yes.
well?
Yes. Okay. Yes, the engineers took all that into account to... keep it a straight line.
And I did like the idea of the truck going up the slope, but is that slope too steep to allow that vehicle to travel? Or do you have to, because when we were talking about it, you were talking about matting, and my understanding was that you're going to put the mats on the wetland area.
Yeah, we can put them on the banking, though, as far up the hill as you know.
So you can still get the truck or whatever vehicle.
Yeah, you can put it at a decent angle without having any problems.
Okay.
I mean, we're not going to just go right for the flat spot. You know,
okay.
that's not necessary.
Okay, great.
I just had a couple questions. So I apologize, I wasn't out there. I know it takes a little bit to get out there. It's an existing or failed pole. So it's failed
structurally.
How so?
So we use a contractor, subcontractor called Avalon.
Mm-hmm.
They test all over the country. They use a resistograph, non-destructive drill bit, basically.
Yep.
And it measures resistance in the wood density. There's an algorithm formula that it, you know, 70% of original strength, and if it's underneath those guidelines that we set, which is, you know, standard utility practice, you know, they deem it.
It's gotta go. Okay, and it's just wondering if is it leaning? Was it?
Yeah, no. It's we're on the aggressive side too. What we determine is a failed pole, so
yeah.
There's no immediate public safety threat. It's not gonna fall down tomorrow, or you know, or even in a year.
Yeah,
it's just being proactive, going out there and finding which poles are potentially have some rot or have some problems that are catch it before it becomes a big deal.
And then my only other question, as far as construction of the new hole, so you're going to use an auger rig, is it going to be a cased hole, or are you just going to try to, I mean, in this wet area, open hole auger is going to be a pretty difficult and messy.
So they're going to use the auger and the case.
Okay. Yeah.
And they kind of have like a custom setup.
Drive
some bars and some pins, and they'll put a big piece of steel through it, and they'll use the auger to attach, and then they'll try to spin that case down.
Yeah, so they'll attach the Kelly bar, spin the casing down first, and then clean out with the auger.
Then we'll go back in with the auger, clean the hole out, put the pole in, and we use 3/4 process stone as backfill.
Okay.
How long do these poles last? On average.
On average? People say 35 to 40 years. There's a lot of documentation on the internet right now. Not a lot of hard facts, but people are starting to realize that it might be more like 60 to 70,
okay.
Believe it or not. It all depends on conditions and strains and loading and all that stuff. But I mean, 30 years is expected.
Questions?
So how much excess material is going to come out of the hole when you clean it out of the tube?
2 feet by 9 feet.
Yeah, fair amount, probably.
Yeah, well,
18 to 24 square feet.
Yeah, but what's that? Where's that going to go?
I thought you said you read all this.
So we're
no, I asked if you did.
We're going to It's our fault that, right, we have those nice masks.
Oh, you're the top, yeah, all right, I missed the top, okay.
Take it out to a non-wetland area and the backhoe that they have that they'll use to backfill the hole.
Okay.
And spread that and just grade it out nice.
Okay.
On our site visit, when you do the project, can you identify that area where you're gonna spread out the soils?
Any other questions from the commission? Any questions from the public? This is pretty straightforward. My motion to.
We haven't prepared anything, I think.
I have.
You have?
Yeah, so you can, we can both then.
Well, do we approve first and then we close?
No, we close and then we wait till we get something and then.
And you issue.
I make a motion to close.
Play that one, this project.
Second.
So that was a favor.
And so you, we have something.
Yeah, sure, something.
Do you wanna take a look at it quickly or?
Yeah. Who wants seconds?
Nothing about like an independent, was it, a law that I have to look out for, is it?
I'm taking this back at the office. So maybe we can catch up and I'll run down and grab it. And you guys can look at it.
So basically what's happened, Chuck's has prepared an order. We just have to take a look and review it, make sure we're in concurrence with the language in there, but he'll grab that at some point and kind of walk through it. Hopefully we can get that signed and approved tonight. We don't have any edits or changes.
It's not even like one we've done before. It's super simple.
Okay.
Two paragraphs.
Unless you have an issue, we can wait.
I don't have an issue, but I would like to bring something up.
Mm-hmm.
I saw the gentleman from Grove Street come in. The meeting for that was at 7:20, and I do believe we said that to you folks out there. I don't know what to say.
No, it's all right. I had an opportunity to review the plans this afternoon.
Oh, okay.
And you know, it was a good discussion, and I think I understand. And,
okay,
all right. Okay with what I heard earlier.
So you just came because this is good entertainment?
No, I wanted to see it and hear. I wanted to really hear the questions and issues that you folks raised. And so I guess, you know, we're a few minutes late in this session. I'm sorry.
That's okay. well, Chuck. Then do you want to go and get that?
Sure.
Take a brief recess.
Just so you know, we actually did discuss some of the things that we discussed with you.
this, I want.
This one can't get fingerprints on it.
Then we get talking, it turns out he knows John's dad.
Yeah.
Very well.
Sure, it's fine.
He worked for John's mother's father. They had a sign company, but they also did the highway lights, those big lights.
Oh, yeah.
Meeting engineer, and that's gonna finish up the project.
On site?
I will stop in there.
I want to place the bounds and go over some other things, so getting ready. It'll be a good opportunity. I did not send it to them.
Oh.
Let's go. The template was for the last project you did, so it's all of the, all of the conditions are the same.
We already told him the ultimate weapon, he knows we can. Project, just let us know. All right. Sounds great.
Do we have a motion to approve?
I make a motion to approve as amended. There were three items I was gonna have taken out there. Item 13 on the special conditions, and then
and A and B on the last page, which is page 17, A and B, and that's part of. Also part of the general special conditions.
Second.
All those in favor?
We're all set.
Thank you.
Thank you guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Uh, Are you coming by to pick it up, or can I send it in to you?
We'll come by tomorrow.
Okay, great. I'll be at, I'm in at 7, I'm in at 8, but I have a site visit just down the street, just near you at Perfecto's, on the Perfecto site, at 9:30. Can meet you there if you want. Can bring it there.
Just come down right away, before you take off.
Sounds good.
All right, thank you.
Okay, we have a request for determination of applicability, 2017-1, Lot B, 0.
I just want, I was doing so many things. Who approved and who seconded?
I made a motion. I don't know who seconded.
We got it. I second everything Mike says.
Oh, and that did have a DEP file number?
No, it's not on the agenda.
I came in today.
Okay. This is RDA for Lot B, 0 Border Road, map 6, Lot 4, Hanson Family Nominee Trust.
Do you want me to speak to that? So we have two residential lots on Border Road. There's a water path that crosses those that leads from a culvert installed by the state of Massachusetts under Route 93. And the water crosses the lots and leads to a culvert installed by the town of Reading under Border Road. The problem that we have is the lot has collected a lot of debris, trash and so forth, as well as debris that's in the water path. So the water backs up on that lot, flooding both lots A and B. So our goal is to clean out, well, first to pick up the trash, be a good neighbor, because it was really pretty messy. And second, to eliminate the backup that occurs and allow the water to flow freely from culvert A to culvert B so that it doesn't flood the lots. The second thing we requested was that we redirect that water path, particularly out near Border Road, to the path that it was on previously before the MRWA backfilled the lot and deflected it further into the lot. Do you know if there were any photographs you were talking about looking at aerial photographs? Oh, mm-hmm. Good.
So, when I came back from the site visit, if that's, you know, let's start from the beginning. I got a call from just reporting that people were working over the weekend on this site. And so I went down there and I found a construction crew, and they were in this area basically, I guess, grubbing it and cutting down some trees. So none of that was happening when I was there. It was pretty much complete. I mean, it was pretty much cleared out. The trees that were going to be cut down were cut down. The guy with the backhoe was working the water course at the far end by the highway. So I asked them all to stop and got up and asked what was going on and what they were trying to do. So it was reported that they were trying to clear up the project. They were trying to take out the weeds, a lot of overgrown stuff, and some dead wood. But, you know, my initial site visit, I noticed that there was more than just dead wood cut down, and there was a lot of clearing. When I asked the operator of the backhoe what he was doing in the water, he said that he was told to move the stream to the border of the lot and bring it around the corner to try to create more room. So he said, well, you know, I don't know what's going on here, but you guys have to stop and we have to get an order of conditions for work like that. So that was basically in the morning, and then by the afternoon, the applicants came down to the town hall, and we discussed what had happened out there and what the next steps are that need to be done, and then the next thing was the site visit, which the commission went on. So they filed an RDA for this work, and which it doesn't, you know, the RDA doesn't mention anything about the stream. but just to clean up the lot and to kind of explain what they were doing. So this commission had a site visit, and at that site visit, there was a lot of questions about what happened when and where and what was how things lined up. So I ended up talking to the engineering department and asked for some pictures. And we did get a few pictures of this area from 74. And this is one of the pictures here that shows, it shows the area. Actually, this isn't the one I wanted to start on. I wanted to start on this one right here. Yeah, let me just call them all up. Trying to find.
Oh, there it is.
There it is.
Yeah.
Where we're heading.
So we're right in this area, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think so.
Yeah, I actually see the stream.
Yeah, because it's South
yeah.
Street.
Oh,
South Street.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is that the stream right here?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
All right, so there.
And what's the date on that?
But it was still.
This says April 4th,
1974. But see, that was the new culvert. That wasn't
so
the old one.
Where does the stream come from? On the other street, across the street.
The stream is, this is South Street, or the new South Street, and here's part of the stream right straight through, underneath the highway, down through, and then across the street. And these look like, in 74, these look like fields. And this might have been, because it is kind of a straight cut.
And it takes another.
It looks like maybe someone was, maybe a farmer, maybe someone was just trying to make this stream get over to a point where it could cross the road easily. Now, as far as it goes up in this direction, not sure.
Can I show you?
It doesn't look like it's on the other side of South Street.
Sure.
I found this. I used to work for the printing company. And this shows that it goes straighter. It's only a tiny little line, but it's right here. It doesn't show it. So this must have been, this is 70.
1976.
Yeah, so you can see it doesn't go at an angle. It comes back down in. I mean, that's all I could find.
That was 76? Is that what you're saying?
Well, this is even before, and I mean, I don't know. I tend to trust an aerial because
yeah.
It is what it is.
Actually, the stream is cuts a little bit
yeah.
more
right.
at an angle across the lot than even that 1974 photograph shows.
And is
but that's the newer culvert.
And this is an intermittent stream?
Don't know.
I'm sure it's not on.
Well, actually.
It's not on stream stats.
Do you have a.
It was intermittent. It does dry up, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah.
Do you have a USGS, Chuck?
I do.
Does that show up blue?
No.
In the summer, there's very little water. I mean, spring, it's spring.
Tell without the property lines.
Right.
sheets of that piece.
Yep. The scale on this is.
That was the only thing that I could find.
But you do see the aerial photo that really depicts it.
I do see the photo, but I think what we need to do is determine when that culvert was put in, because that's key to the whole thing.
Well, actually, no, not really. It is what it is. You know, you've got a resource area, it seems, there. And I don't know if it's perennial, excuse me, or not. And it doesn't matter when or what, you know, it looks like there was a stream upstream coming down from West Street, so that there was drainage going from South Street down to Border Road. Chuck said that Border Road used to go into South Street, and it was all Border Road, I think.
It was.
South Street, Border Road was South Street.
Right.
So where there's the cul-de-sac at the end, that went up the hill, and there was no South Street.
But what I'm saying is, you know, a resource area is what it is today. Sometimes things happen over several years, and that's what we have to look and evaluate at this point. You know, where is the resource area? And to my eyes, it looked like a resource area. There was flowing water. What I thought was a little disturbing was it seemed like that there was a lot of disturbance, cutting, but also I could see tracks that kind of mucked up the stream closer towards 93. There was like a depression and there's some water in there.
That's where he actually brought that machine.
Right, well.
The depression.
Yeah. I don't think it was, you know, a lot of water in there previous, because it looked like it was a channelized stream.
Well, there's no, the water is blocked as it comes out from under the culvert because of all the debris at the end.
Which culvert, the 93 culvert?
The 93. And then it sort of flattens out, and then there's no real stream bed until it gets a little closer to Border Road. And so that's why it just sort of floods out, because he didn't touch the stream bed at that point. He was beside it.
The town engineering department did agree.
I'm sorry, what?
The town engineering department did agree to take a look at the culvert at Border Road, and I think probably
did. Yeah, the engineering, the highway department down there too.
That would be under the jurisdiction of
Mass Highway, yeah.
Yes, correct. And there's, of course, one going back and forth. Nothing is, they haven't been out there evaluating yet. They agreed to look at it.
Did you folks do any work there?
The highway department.
Who put in those large rocks along Border Road?
I think it's MWRA. I don't know.
I can answer that.
Oh.
I'm sorry.
Your name is?
Charlene Bazarian. I'm at 40 Border Road. I just wanted to come to see what was going on, because we noticed a lot of work going on there too. But the rocks were put there when they hooked up the Mass Water Resources, that thing on the other side of the street, and they put those stainless steel poles. And the town was, or I assume it was the town, or when they were doing the construction, they were parking trucks on that wetland area, and I called to complain, because I said they were disturbing the area with the water, and there was water coming into the street, and they were turning the cars around, and gravel was being dumped there, and so the...
What year do you think that?
2007-ish.
Oh, okay.
That sounds about right. And so then one of the selectmen came down, and actually we walked up and down the whole street. We're talking about everything that the street had been through with the highway expansion. And it was we went all the way down the end of the street, and then they put the rocks there to prevent cars from turning around in there. And then they agreed to put some shrubbery around that box that they put with the water. So that's when the rocks, got placed there. That was.
Did you take a look at that?
Thank you.
A culvert structure at Border Road?
I don't know if the highway department has had a chance to go out there and take a look at it.
It doesn't look like it's in really good condition.
As like most of our culverts, they probably are not. We have a lot of them.
Yeah.
So this is the highway construction plan. It shows
culvert.
shows a couple of things. So, I think this is just the layout.
Chuck, could you point out South Street on there, or Border Road, whichever it was at the time?
So this is your street up here. Going down there, which is New Border Road.
Okay.
This is the highway.
Oh, okay.
Layout right across.
Mm-hmm.
This is South, this would be South Street down in this area here now.
Now, mm-hmm.
So this is the culvert, goes across. This is tree grow. This is just canopy of the trees right in those areas. But again, this was somewhere on here, it says 1956. And I think we just did this now, but it's highlighted and the stream is angled just like that. But you know, I asked Ryan, does the highway department ever put in a culvert when there's no need to do it? And he assured me there was no such policy. So there was water in this area when the highway went in, and they determined that this was a low spot. And that's why they have a culvert here. And it's discharged on this end.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if we go back to this plan here, I think what you can see, as you can see this, pretty straight lines of where it comes out, then turns, and then goes right into the culvert. That's probably not natural, and someone dug that and made the water kind of angle into that direction, but it wasn't after 74.
Why would they not continue that straight across the Border Road? Why would they deflect it across the center of the property?
I don't know when this culvert was put in place, but it's coming out right here.
Right.
Yeah.
Coming across.
Well, so no, I understand that part. I'm saying it takes a turn halfway across to get to the town culvert, which is not placed in line with the state culvert.
Was Border Road there before 93?
Border Road was South Street.
Yeah. So there would have already been a culvert. Okay, let me just finish my sentence.
Okay,
so,
sorry.
It's okay. So there was already a culvert under Border Road at that location.
No. It may have been.
There was a stream. Does it show further up on there? There was a stream.
On the other side of 93?
Up here.
Yeah, you can see it.
Way up here. Where's the old one? This home.
Mm-hmm.
We used to call it the mansion, and this was the caretaker's home. There was a stream that ran, it was a small hill, so it must have run like here. And then they diverted it this way, and then they went underneath.
It looks like there's something there in a stream.
Yeah,
right,
there's a stream.
So,
but I think it was closer to here, and then it came across and then went down underneath.
So perhaps where that culvert is, that was where that just was many, many years, even before the highway was built. That might have been just a low spot that the culvert was put in to go underneath Border Road prior to 93 even being there.
It went underneath Border Road, which used to be South Street, but it was further
towards West Street.
Towards West Street.
Yeah.
So they moved to the culvert?
Moved the culvert.
It must have been before.
Because I think it was just a big hole. It was no catch basin or anything. It was just a culvert under the road, and it spilled in across the street, and it used to flood the fields of Russell Farms.
Yeah.
So you're saying the culvert was straight across?
More
straight across.
Well, we actually, when we did the site walk, if you walk to that point, Chuck, you can see that it's all dug out in that area.
Where? There?
Where?
I thought that was, remember the clump of trees that was there?
No, I'm not talking about there. I'm talking about the fact that...
You mean across on Border?
There is a depression that starts here.
is a depression that goes down through here.
Yeah.
You and I looked at that.
Yeah, there's a big clump of rocks right there.
Right in here that looks like it may have been in this concrete in it too. Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know, do you know when the last time this road was repaved? Because there's no sign of any culverts being cut in.
I can tell you my design.
What's the RDA for?
I'm trying to get a perspective here, and I appreciate we're trying to figure out what's out there and what it was.
But the point is that I was trying to make very early on is we have to evaluate what's there, not what was.
Yeah.
You know, major highway, went in, and that changes drainage. You're getting runoff from 93, all that pavement into that culvert. So there's a source of water, so feeding that stream. And we have to look at that as our resource area. So the work that you've been doing out there, you know, you should have been filing. I want to say a notice of intent because it was quite a bit of disturbance. You were cutting down trees. And we have a pretty strict tree replacement policy.
We were unaware.
As homeowners, you know, maybe, you know, you should have called Chuck or somebody.
There was one tree that he did cut down because it was totally encased in vines.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, do you want to take it down? He said, it's dead anyway. And the other one said he took down.
We're dead.
Most of them were.
But we didn't have the opportunity to look at those and you know, evaluate them.
I'm not saying you couldn't have. We're just saying.
So what's being proposed?
Well, the first thing is to clear the path so that the water can flow as intended, because right now it's not. It's blocked in several places with branches and leaves, and it just diffuses across the lots. So we don't want to prevent the flooding on the lots, including the basement of the house next to it.
And so when you say cleaning it out and removing what's in there, is it branches, things that can be moved?
Accumulation of leaves.
And are we talking about an excavator getting in there?
No, I don't think so. The strange thing is there was a lot of trash in there too, but we had an odd circumstance where somebody in the town of Reading came and cleared much of the trash a week ago. What's his name?
John Oliver.
Yeah, I think you're right. He's a local Robin Hood of trash collection.
And it was wonderful he did it. The timing was a little odd.
Because I walked in and I saw this guy out of the lot, and it was, that day it was pouring rain, and I thought, hi, who are you? And he said, oh, I'm just cleaning this up. I saw the notice in the paper, so I'm just cleaning it up. And I thought, oh, okay, we've got a hearing next Wednesday, and we're talking about the debris on the lot, and now it's all next to the street.
This is a private property, right? He just decides to go right up.
Yeah.
Okay.
Anyway,
but he told
him
I was.
Nice job.
Okay, you know what? I mean, I'm sure you're not complaining that you got trash picked up. No, it's a.
So at the very least, we want to make it so that the water can flow from one culvert to another. If we have to live with that condition, then we have to, The fact that the culvert is there, there's not much we can do about that.
And I mean, it was pretty much an eyesore before. It was so overgrown and
you would
trashy.
Agree.
That would, yeah, it collected trash like you can't. I mean, my sons and I would sometimes in the spring bring a trash can down and fill it up, and that was when we eventually had the rocks put up just because it was getting out of hand, the dumping from the Dunkin' Donuts and just people just going by.
There were barrels and a van seat and other things there that people had tossed out.
So is there, I didn't do the site work, Becky, is there an issue with the tree policy here?
Good question.
Yeah, so there was several trees cut down. There was a lot of brush that was cleared. And there's some disturbance at the far end by the highway of, of this wet area. So is it wetland? Not sure. Really just looked at it as kind of what had happened here, but in you know, I don't think it would take much. The water's not jumping out of the channel. It seems to be making its way pretty well from one end to the other, but there is some water in back of the house that's there. That house right here, and there's some water in this area, but it had just rained, so I don't know if that's some of this work too.
Wasn't that behind the right-of-way fence, though, Mass Highways? Because it was...
Most of it is.
Yeah, that's what I thought. It was puddled here and puddled there beyond the stream, right at, you know, as the culvert comes out in I-93.
But the banks of what you can see in this picture versus what exists now, it's kind of spilled over and made a larger water course than is what's evident here from this picture.
So is there a way that we could figure out how many trees were removed? I mean, most people, when they do clearing, they don't grub, they don't really they cut them.
So, yeah, they just cut the trees.
Probably. Okay, I could see some stumps.
Come up with some idea of what was taken out.
Well, I think you got a couple different things, right? You can do an RDA for trash pickup, right? And we're probably pulling stuff out of the stream by hand. But you can't, if you're going to do something in a wetland, you typically have to delineate it first in some fashion to say, yeah, we all agree this is where the wetland starts and stops, and within the protected area, typically within 25 feet of the protected area, we don't allow any tree removal or any disturbing the soil or changing the channel of the stream or anything like that. Right, I mean, that's normally how you do it. So we could do an RDA to clean up the trash and to hand remove things from the stream probably. Beyond that, I think you probably have to say...
It sounds like that's all they want to do. It probably makes sense. I agree.
But didn't I just hear there's an excavator?
Chuck ran them off. They're gone.
But it also says in here... redirect flow, we want to bring the water path to its original intended location. So
we're not going to allow them to redirect flow.
So you wouldn't do that unless you did a lot of engineering work first to make the environment better than it is today. Which is hard to do when water's flowing through its natural course after 25 or 50 years.
It probably makes sense to even an RDA stipulate no more equipment, whatever work's going to be done going forward, cleaning up is done by hand, the channel and whatever else you're going to get out of there. Mm-hmm. And I think we should probably have Chuck go out, and you may have to plant 4 or 5 blueberry bushes or some wetland species in a designated spot if you think.
Well, so when you...
I don't know. What are you laughing?
I'm just laughing because you weren't out there, and you're looking at 30,000 feet, and you're coming up with a plan, and I think that you need to be there to understand the amount of damage that was done. I mean, we're here to protect the environment.
Well, what's your suggestion then?
I'm going to let others talk, because it doesn't all have to come from me, but I think you got a good start, but I'm not sure.
I agree. I think you were on the right track. I don't know that the specific numbers and things you were...
Chuck's right. I haven't seen it, but he doesn't even know if it's a wetland. You said you didn't even know it was a wetland. You said it was wet.
It's probably wet on the edge. What were those thorny... What those were?
Well, the fact is that most everything...
It's starting to come up in the water course.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Well, that... Yeah, I'm not saying that I don't think that's a wetland, but...
You can't really... We won't be able to tell with vegetation because it's been basically denuded.
Right.
But at a minimum, this is a stream with bank. Even if it were ephemeral, it would still have bank, so that you still have a resource area. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I don't know what your intentions are. I was thinking ahead, you probably want to develop this. That's why you probably wanted to redirect the stream.
We don't have any immediate plans, but we have been paying taxes on residential lot since 1957, so yeah, we think that someday.
So I guess in the short run.
If you use that photograph as a definition of the path, you can also use the photograph as a definition of the path. It is there is no wetlands around it. It's just a straight stream.
And it's clear. There's
no
growth
tree,
on there.
Okay.
I would have to disagree with you, okay? Because you can't, from that photo.
I'm just showing the field because obviously if we have a farm here, this could have been a farm and this could have been a wetland, and channelizing the wetland will allow you to plant on either side of it. So you know, that could be a possible reason why this looks straight and it's connected over here and we have a farmhouse somewhere and, you know, one of these old historic houses.
This was a tree nursery.
That's a farm, right? So this could be, trees aren't going to grow in water. You'd have to bring in some topsoil and raise it up and create a stream. And the fact that it was around in 74 means it's jurisdictional. So right where it is now is what you have to deal with.
The stream.
Yeah. And I think you know, just the work that you've done, there wasn't a lot of trees cut down. It was a lot of brush, which will probably grow back in, but there were a few trees cut down. And it certainly does, you know, make me think that you didn't understand the process of the conservation office, the regulations in town, but now you do. Mm-hmm. And we really have to deal with the work that you've done. So, I mean, I would suggest that I should go back out there, maybe some of the commission too, but at least me, go out and count the trees that were alive that you cut down. And then you're going to have to plant some trees for those in kind.
Okay.
And as far as the water course work, we could discuss it there if there's like a stick or something. I didn't really see anything that I would think really needs to be addressed, except for that guy was driving.
Right.
Yeah.
But how is that going to get fixed? I'm not sure, but we could
the
probably
discuss
that.
The ground is relatively flat there, so the stream isn't flowing through.
Problem is we can't fix that by hand. I don't think that's the concern. The machine dug.
So where the water spreads out, that's going to be a wetland. I mean, that's covered in water and saturated, and then it channelizes and becomes a stream. So where you're saying, well, we don't want it to spread out. We want to keep it in the stream.
Right.
Yeah.
That's we need to find out if that's jurisdictional wetland first.
Yeah, that's counter to what we're. If it's doing it now, that's counter to what we don't want to channelize it more. We want it to be able to spread. We want it to be able to back up. It's supplying storage when the water is, you know, when there are high storms. It has value to have that condition.
But it's backing up because the stream bed is filled with leaves and stuff.
Branches.
It can't flow.
It's not filled with leaves now. It's pretty clear.
I mean,
can we meet you when you go out there?
The point of a wetland is, it's a buffer for the downstream flow of water. So the reason that you hear about Winchester flooding when there's a lot of rain is because the upstream in the Abergeona watershed, particularly in Woburn, a lot of the wetlands have been channelized by concrete. And so the water just races to Winchester,
mm-hmm.
or Arlington,
Winchester,
and it floods. When the water here has the ability to slow down and spread out and sort of trickle through plants, it slows all the flow of water so that downstream you don't have flooding. And that was the whole point of the wetland, or one of the major reasons
for protection. It's one of the performance standards.
That's why it's there. So when you have a channel, the water races through, and you see that in Worcester in the Blackstone River, it just races through. And you end up, you flood your neighbors. And so that's why we don't incur, that's why it's prohibited from channelizing a wetland.
So I would finish off by saying for this, you're probably gonna get a positive determination with some conditions to replant.
Mm-hmm.
And not go into that area, no matter what your intentions are. And then when it becomes over-vegetated again, to come in for a permit or pursue that development dream and hire a consultant who can talk to us in our language.
Mm-hmm.
And then relay to you what you need to do to make this a marketable piece of property.
Okay.
Because I think that you're focused in on the stream and you don't have to be, because it might be okay even where the stream is.
Okay.
So.
Short
of making a decision.
I mean, it sounds like, despite what you just said about the decision, are we talking about waiting until this next site visit and number of trees, or
I can go back out and I can bring back some more information if that's what you want, and talk about the plan.
Well, I'll do it tomorrow after Perfectos if you want, if you have time.
You buy me lunch?
Yeah, I'll take you to your favorite French restaurant.
I don't eat lunch. So
La Mickey D.
Yeah, La Mickey D. All right. So that would be about 10 o'clock, 10:30, if you guys
right.
are around.
Yep, we'll
yep.
be around.
We will be there.
Okay.
Great.
I can't do that, but I can go take a peek on the weekend.
Yeah.
I mean, now that you've filed a request for determination, it gives the commission a right to go into the property.
Mm-hmm.
But since you're here, is it okay if
yes,
we visit
it is.
The site?
Sure.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay.
I don't know if the highway department, the engineering department said that they can work in the first 10 feet of the culvert, but there's no easement on the lot to do any more than that.
So the highway department can do, do work, but I think it is pretty cleaned out, so we're not going to have them do anything other than if they wanted to jet the culvert out, that
yep.
would be fine. But as far as working up 10 feet from the culvert, I think we're going to... That's going to be your job. We're
okay.
going to try to get a permit that allows you to do that if needed.
Yeah, in the highway department, they did clean the end of it out because there was junk in the stream and there were cardboard cartons and things like that. And they did take them out. They were there the same day as our mysterious John Oliver.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe he cleaned it out.
He could have cleaned it out too. I don't know.
The downstream end, and they're working upstream.
They did say there was some blockage further up, and they wanted to get this resolved before resolving the one upstream, which makes sense.
We've looked at other properties in the same area that's part of the stream, and I think that's on some master list, if there's such a thing, but it's definitely known, and site visits have happened. It's part of it, but that would only bring more water
yeah, well
through.
That, yeah, that I was hoping they were looking at the one downstream.
Take the
one
downstream out before.
Right. Okay.
Okay.
Good. Thank you.
So we can be there. Motion to.
I make a motion to continue.
Yeah.
Second.
All those in favor.
Thank you very
much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks for sticking around, guys.
We have a request for determinability for 24 Plymouth Road, 2017-3, map 26, lot 102, Callaghan. We met with you out in the field the other day.
That's correct.
And you can explain your project.
Yeah, pretty straightforward. Looking to put a fence in the backyard. Pretty much the outline of the backyard to the back of the wetlands, and butting up to my porch on one side and the other side of the house. So, relatively straightforward.
Is that in the 25, Chuck?
Oh, yeah, it's existing lawn. I took some pictures, but I lost them all. They don't. So we have super tight restrictions on, so I can't email from my phone to my work email. So those pictures are...
On your phone?
Not around. I can show you if you want. I have my phone right here. But right at this edge, right here, let me just get this right. So here's the...
It's a proposed fence.
Right.
Yeah.
Hand up over here.
And, I mean, it shows back here, but it probably comes up, you know, right up in here. And, so I think all this is right in here, just like that. Probably some fill, looks a little unnatural in that area, but...
Well, there's a landscaped area with some bushes.
And that would be right about here. There was something in this area.
Oh, that was an old garden.
Yeah, there was an old raised bed that I actually just took out in about that area, yeah.
So, you know, in all actuality, that was probably in the wetland. He's removed that. It's gonna be beyond the fence in the wetland, and he's just gonna allow whatever was, that seed bank that was in it. So I don't know if that's gonna be corn or we're talking Phragmite. But he's just gonna let that go at this point.
I thought it was cattail, it wasn't frag.
Yeah, so cattail or, you know.
It's mostly all cattail back there.
So up to the wetland line is
so
cured
so
grass.
I didn't finish off. So there is an existing lawn right at the edge.
The wetland, yeah.
There's no room, so there's no other room. I mean, the yard's not that big. It's existing lawn, and then where he's putting the fence, and I did tell him that the commission could move it up or down, and he was cool with that. He said, I don't care. I just want something. But when you go out there, you know, there's really no other place to put it. It just doesn't belong anywhere else.
What's the measurement from the back of your house to the proposed fence on the rear lot line there? Roughly, is it 20 feet, 30 feet, 40 feet?
30
feet.
Probably. To the back of the house, so there's a deck. The deck was probably 25. The house is 35-ish.
35 from the proposed fence?
Yeah.
Yeah. You have a measurement here from the back of the house to the back of where the fence is. It's 32 feet.
Sweet.
So okay. I would say from the back of the house to the back where the wetland line is, it's about 30 feet,
what kind
30, 35 feet.
Yeah. What kind of fence are we talking about?
Just a vinyl white picket, 4 feet high.
We allow fences in that, typically, right?
Yeah.
We have.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't see a problem with that. I'm just asking.
Are there any cement footings, concrete footings, or are you just going to...
Just the white, the 4x4 vinyl pole just goes in the hole, right?
I don't think there will be any cement. There shouldn't be.
No, there shouldn't be. We could...
I think this is
that.
Fine.
I disagree completely. No, I'm just joking.
Getting tired.
I didn't see any problem when I went out to the site with the fence.
I flew my satellite over and took a look.
Like style.
Mr. Google.
Any other issues or comments or thoughts?
I don't have
so
any thoughts.
So you're going to let that garden revert to natural wetland, right?
Yeah. I'm probably going to rake out some of the weeds and whatever was in there, but I'm just going to leave it.
Should we be having something seeded there? Do we want to try to control what it is, or...?
You've got cattails that are just going to go.
Yeah,
they're going to creep up. But we should ask that you monitor that for invasives. I could put that. I don't have I do have the order. We could just write that in, and I could amend it.
Do you know what he means by invasives?
Yeah, there are some there. We've been trying to take care of them. They wrap around some of the trees that are there and things like that. So we've been trying to remove them as best we can.
There's that, and there's some other things that could be identified. But maybe we could just request a site visit next spring, and check, and when something's actually growing in, it's easier for me to point it out and say, you want to remove these things.
Absolutely.
So that would
questions from the commission? Public? Hearing none.
I make a motion, negative determination, with the amendment that we would do a site visit to look for invasives next spring.
During the growing season.
During the growing season.
Please, your second.
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you, Mr. Callahan.
Thank you.
Very much.
Thank you.
Go in peace.
Hope the show was worth the wait.
He was,
hold on the last one.
He was in the aisle seat.
The aisle seat, no, we make the troublemakers go first.
No, ooh, sir.
Because I was dead last.
Just continuing the certificate of compliance for 100 Main.
I made a call to Libby Wallace. We were going to work on that together. Libby was at the site visit and asked her, this time I'll send out an email too, but if you guys have some recollection on, I have a list, but I want to make sure that my list, I'll put my list in the email, and then if there's anything that needs to be added for that site visit they need to complete prior to getting their certificate of compliance.
Which site is this?
This is Artist.
Artist? Oh, 1000.
The one we talk about all the time that never gets done.
So they need to move the concrete bound, they need to lower the wetland that's been replicated. I think those are the two things I had.
Yeah, I think back when we went, we wanted to install, did you say that?
Right,
that
the
install some more.
Some posts with
right.
signs.
And then some vegetation hadn't mm-hmm. grown in yet. And around some areas.
And then there was the section of the wetland that was high.
Yeah. I drove by that today and it's noticeably uneven.
Noticeably uneven, like water can't flow to.
So there's no, it's basically at the higher level of the replication area is at the water line. And so you get standing water in the old wetland and then.
Yeah. They weren't paying attention when they graded.
So it just needs to go down a few inches.
That's the best way to say it, but I think they were there. I think Libby was there. I think we talked about it a lot. And it was concerning, and there was this tree that they didn't want to take down, so they tried to move the whole thing. It ended up wrong, but there was a lot of eyes on it from Hayes Engineering. So we're working on it. That's the update.
Have you come to terms with the neighbor to put the
that's all finished.
That
you know,
side.
I was a little disappointed with the fence that they put up there. There was a barrier at the end of her driveway. I don't know what that is.
That's work.
There was a barrier at the end of the driveway, and they said that they were going to put in 6x6 posts or 6x8 posts, and then run an 8x6 across, like you might see at a DCR site. As a guardrail, it ended up being 6x6 with a, you know, 2x12, ran across it. So it's the same job, but.
But did you also request the identification?
Well, yeah, Harry said that. I said that.
To the side, up
so
the side of that driveway.
That's definitely happening. And a new issue came up tonight. I was talking to Ryan about, and I don't know if anyone remembers this, back before this project even started, the side of the pond blew out, and it was a bunch of erosion, and no one could tell what that was about, and they investigated, but nothing ever came up. So they put some pea stone in there, and they put a piece of granite to retain the pea stone before it went into the pond, and we all waited. And Hayes did some investigation, but said they have no idea what happened. So now, just a couple weeks ago, we find out the area across the street is flooding. And one of the possible reasons is that somewhere under that area that blew out, there's a drainage culvert that was blocked up. So. So there's going to be more work in the same area with heavy equipment soon.
So there's a blocked up culvert under the Artist parking lot, perhaps? Or
well, it's really where the snow storage area is.
Okay.
And so it kind of goes straight across the street through the snow storage area and then to the edge of the pond. But the culvert wasn't visible even where it was blown out, and it must have been blown out 5 feet, so 5 feet from back from the edge. This has happened to you before, huh?
No, I mean, there's just a problem they'll never fix.
Now you gotta fix it now.
They're gonna find it?
I don't, well, you know, I don't actually know if they're going to fix it. I just know that they're looking for reasons why it's flooding across the street.
Yeah.
And this is...
They're gonna come up with one that is not a buried culvert.
That's exactly it. That's what I'm...
they're looking for volunteers to go down the culvert at the other end and see what's blocking it.
Camera.
So...
You don't have the other end, right?
I don't know what's gonna happen. I know we have a bond on that, and I know that if they have to destroy or rebuild the edge of the pond, that's part of what our bond's used for. It couldn't repair a culvert, but it could fix that, and it can fix the wetland that you're worried about and everyone's worried about because it has this high spot in it, so the connectivity isn't there. That would also be another good on-your-own site visit to see what's happening with all this rain.
Why would our bond fix that? They should just fix it, right? We have an issue to...
Yeah, we're not going to take the bond. They'll fix it, right?
Yeah.
I don't think there's going to be a problem at all with someone fixing it,
right?
But just in case, we still have a bond.
Right.
No one else has
okay.
a bond.
All right.
Yeah, that's more...
That's more...
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, I meant that. So we're still protected. Keolis Consumer Services... Commuter Services is sent a operation and maintenance plan. So they're going to be spraying herbicide on their right of way. And the dates are the 8th of May through 11th of June, and then August 1st through 31st. And they wrote the same thing twice. So if anyone out there listening, we're going to put this on our website, anyone out there listening does not want herbicides or wants some information on herbicides, to contact the conservation office, and we can flag off your area to not receive herbicide spray. We also went through the plan a couple years back and had them issue. We issued a determination of applicability. We reviewed the map, including walking down the whole site and the right of way, and checking to see if there was any additional vernal pools or additional wetlands, but they were all clearly marked and it was exactly as the plan. I think we moved one, so that's one thing that was in your packet.
Chuck, is this is the
that was in our packet.
We approved this earlier.
Yeah,
in the
it
year.
Didn't look like this. It looked like a piece of paper. Okay. Yeah.
Right.
We approved this not too long ago to do it, and they're just telling us the dates now.
Well, it's yearly.
Yeah.
They probably did it last year too.
Yeah, they were here.
Yeah, they were here, and they went through. They did a great job presenting how they're going to spray and everything.
Yeah, I have. Yeah, it was last year, as a matter of fact. So that permit's good for 3 years.
Yeah. Okay.
So
they're just telling us now when they're going to be here, right?
I think they told us last year. If you're just saying, is this the first time they tell us? Or am I getting your...
No, I'm just wondering why you're telling us this stuff.
He's just confirming that the only reason you're telling us about this is because they're informing us. And the answer is yes.
You are the pulse of this community. This is coming up. If you think that you want to check it out again before they do this, you have an opportunity until, you know, August... or in sometime in June.
Sorry for my confusion.
So here's another one. This is the same lines. This is the pulse of the community here. So the Division of Fish and Wildlife is opening up their, you know, the map they put out there, the natural heritage map.
Yep.
So they're asking all the commissions to look at that and to specifically look at features that need to be deleted or added. So again, this is the entire town though. So that, I believe that was also in your packet, and it opens up for comment on April 3rd and it will end June 3rd. So you might feel
like
look at
Strawberry Lane.
Oh, did you just say that?
There you go.
It is interesting that this is peeper season and salamander season. We
we'd learn a lot more if Becky was here. I mean, if Anika was here, she loves salamanders.
She does.
But,
Was she talking about photosynthetic?
Photosynthetic salamander
algae
eggs.
Going into the cells of the salamander.
But, so this is the time of year when you actually can hear peepers and see fairy shrimp and those sorts of things, so good catch. And I was out at the Ipswich River a couple of times recently, including Sunday, trying to catch stocked brown trout, which were put in last week.
Were you fly fishing or?
Yeah, which was silly.
Did you use you were using a worm on that though?
No.
That was your secret you were telling
no,
me?
No, no.
Okay.
But
tell people the secret.
There's basically, and I don't know if it really applies to this, but the river died last year. I mean, it literally, no fish survived, which is kind of sad. Because
yeah.
Last spring, you could look off the bridge before they stocked and see 12, 14, 16-inch brook trout up above the bridge on Mill Street.
Oh, wow.
And there's, I mean, they did not live.
Sure they didn't, because that was all dried out, remember?
It was just a mud puddle, and they need cold, clear water. So, Chuck, what I think they also lost is the invertebrates, so it's
wildlife
years before it comes back.
They wouldn't have lost all the invertebrates, because upstream it would have still been
wet. I'll send you it.
Wet.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I thought it was in that packet.
But
they don't,
big sections.
Yeah, I agree, but
yeah.
You didn't lose all of them.
So, anyway,
carry fighting.
And there's good information on the Ipswich River Watershed Association's website about how they could have actually kept the stream flowing if people used less water in town, that sort of thing. So community service announcement is directly related to that, but it really fries me that we've got this nice river and it completely dried up and killed all the wildlife.
Think of what they did
with
California.
You should have been happy when we went on to MWR.
Yeah, I know. It's better.
Because we
it's better.
Yeah. Withdrew.
Remember the war that this town went through, that people wanted to stay on that, about that aquifer?
It's a much better solution to go to the MWR.
I was told that that's the second most endangered
aquifer. My water bill
is
like $3,000.
Yeah.
And North Reading is moving off
yeah.
Wells. So Wilmington's the last big town above us.
And that's the source of the Ipswich.
So that's a big, they take out like 3 million gallons a day of water from the watershed. So, and then they have further, more problems down.
Chuck, you got Pond Meadow to report?
I do, but I have a couple more things first.
Well, what about the National Grid?
National Grid wants to do a project as a courtesy, what's the word? So they just want a courtesy notification to the Conservation Commission because, and I hope you receive this in your packet, they're going to work on Forest Street, and there's only one section near Spruce Road where they're, at the end they're also near it, but at Spruce Road they're within the 100 foot, about probably 90 feet away. And over on Grove Street, where a forest hits Grove, down the bottom of the hill, they're within 100 feet. So, no, they're not within 100 feet. They're about 120 feet away at Grove Street. So this is kind of a typical right-of-way project. They have BMP standards that they use. They put in straw wattle, they put in silt sacks. They sweep at the end of the day. It's pretty much cut and filled. They'll abandon the line in place. If it needs to be taken, they'll take it out, but they usually don't do that. So they're looking for an approval to move ahead, or just an answer to the question, do they need to file? Or is this courtesy notification enough? Did you have a chance to look at this?
I thought that said in their letter that they're exempt from it.
Yeah, they are exempt under the Wetlands Protection Act. They're not exempt under the...
Under our bylaws.
Yeah.
They're doing this so we don't go running out there in the middle of the project and ask them what the heck they're doing.
No, right. I think we have a pretty good
yeah, I mean, they just,
you know, report. rapport with these people. We've asked them to file sometimes, and other times it just didn't seem needed.
I think that, I mean, they're being pretty proactive at the fact that they're coming to us when it's 90 feet away.
That's what I mean, yeah.
So.
This is a high grief.
This is not the right project to make them come in. Well, I personally.
I agree. Is this, are they also repaving this section of Forest Street?
I think the repaving thing, so they were repaving the whole thing.
Yeah, from.
That would be.
So they're doing this before?
Yeah.
Make sure Ryan knows.
Chris. Once they do it, I think this, what is it, a 5-year moratorium? You can't.
You open it, but you just have to do the formal fill and. What's the other thing, infrared?
So, does it say in here?
We're gonna vote on this, or are we just?
That's the exact same section of Forest Street.
Yeah. So is this, when does it say they're gonna do this?
We need to vote if we're not, we're just saying, well, maybe.
You need to just say whether you think it, you need.
I make a motion that they don't need to come in.
I second the motion.
All those in favor?
So they'll talk to the town right about.
Just not make a motion. Somebody else is gonna do something.
Emergency permit to Pond Meadow Drive?
Yeah. Pond Meadow Drive, this came up before, if anyone's on the commission for a long time. Pond Meadow Drive, there's a culvert that has some trees growing in the culvert and around the culvert. And in the past, we've allowed them to do the work under an emergency permit to cut the trees, one tree, as close as they can to the water. And they did that a couple years back, but now the trees have grown again, and they wanted to do the same thing. So I wrote an emergency permit for this because it was actually backing up into the back area and flooding a parking. And Ryan said that, you know, it's becoming an issue. George Strazzeri, who's the highway DPW director, he also said that it was a problem. So I wrote an emergency permit. They cut out a total of 6 trees. Only 2 big trees, and the rest were about 4-inch caliper trees, and they were all growing in the water. So what would end up happening is any debris would come down and get tangled in that, and then it would get to the culvert, which was partially blocked with a root growing down it. So the Forest Department went down there and they made some really nice cuts, and under the bank was disturbed. It was as good a job as they did in the past. So, but they're all gone now. But I do have a emergency certificate form that needs to be signed for that project.
Up on his motions. I make a motion we approve all minutes from the beginning of time until tonight.
And then there's the minutes.
You want to second that, Chuck?
I want you to talk to the selectmen about allowing the video to be the minutes. It's not only is it make the meetings easier, but it's cost savings too. I mean, we pay our minutes.
So you're gonna, if you don't have to take the minutes anymore, you're going down to 20 hours a week?
I took this on because they didn't have anyone. I'm doing this also. But
I agree.
Yeah, I don't know how that becomes part of it, but I know Anika spoke to the selectman about it.
You should ask him when he was here.
Yeah, John's a good contact person. So, anyways, we do have minutes. The 2 highlighted ones, I sent you one in the packet. I never sent the other one, so you can't approve it.
I don't know that I saw any minutes.
You didn't see the minutes? It was in the packet.
No.
One guy has them.
I got it.
Not in the packet. You hand-delivered to me.
No, I don't have one. I didn't have one.
And Dave.
All right, so we're gonna reload again. I'll do it. You want to take a minute to look at it, or do you want to do it next week?
No.
Next week.
Next two weeks.
Too much already.
I would make a motion to accept the minutes of March, the meeting of March 8th, 2017.
Second.
Wait a minute. Recreate microbarography?
Who cares?
You've got the video if we need anything.
What is that word?
Oh, I couldn't tell ya.
I mean,
Dave was trying to trick us with this.
Be honest, Chuck, if we need to keep something, if it's a battle of what we need to keep, let's just keep the votes. We'll put that in the minutes, and that's it.
That's what we should do.
I mean, I think that's what you should be doing from now on.
Bare minimal.
Yeah, well, that's it. Just keep the votes. Who motioned, who voted, and then that's it. And then we can go back to the video for anything else.
Refer to the video. I'm telling you, I go to communities. Nobody's doing this.
Yeah. I think that's the best thing.
I like it. I think I'll take a little bit more than the vote, but it'll take less than I have been.
Yeah, you know, who showed up? A general outline of the discussion and the vote. Instead of, you know...
Don't say general outline of the discussion. That's vague. That's what he's doing right here with four pages is a general outline.
We'll do less of a general outline.
I have radio buttons on my form that they didn't like. I was deeply hurt by that. Click, 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 done. Did you see that?
No, I don't know.
It's a work of art.
Was that that thing?
Yeah, it was that thing. It was a lot of paper, but it was completely automated.
We had a motion in a second.
I got some. Just minor.
As amended.
As amended.
As amended.
Okay.
All those in favor?
Let's say that again.
Yeah.
Mike's a young guy. He would have liked my format.
Just ran around. He would have.
Jesus, wow.
I just want to make you aware that we're starting to get letters from Harold Ave about 116 Van Norton. So the property in the back, that's going to be developed. So we got a couple of letters in opposition of that project.
Which?
So Van Norton was that?
It hasn't been brought to us yet.
It hasn't been brought to us. I think they're just keeping us aware of the opposition that the direct neighbors that live on Harold Ave, which would be the entrance to this project, are in opposition of this for different reasons. One, that's a private road. I mean, things that's not conservation generally, but I'm keeping them, and I'll send them out when we have when someone submitted an application.
Is this that lot that they just cleared not too long ago with the skidder?
No, that's the potato chip truck lot.
Oh, okay.
I didn't think there was any room to build back there.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, there's a lot of space.
I think it's three.
Maybe someone will be before.
Because they have not too far from there. On the end of that street, there's another lot that's across the street that almost looks like a pork chop lot.
There's a lot of open land up there. There's a lot of open land up there.
Well, I think we got to prepare our, if we're going to have controversial filings, we got to prepare our speech, listen, if this thing meets the criteria, it's going to be approved. We can't not approve it because you don't like it.
Yeah.
I think they just have to go through, and we have to go through the
struggle
every time.
Whoa. Pertinent information. If there's 20 people here, and they're all going to be able to say the same thing.
Yes, I agree.
If you have pertinent new information, you're welcome to bring it to the board. If you're going to stand up and say I used to play in that field, we don't want to hear it.
Can I ask about the appeal process in general? I know we had a meeting today. Our decision on that site was to not approve a line based on not enough information. We had gone to them and talked about potentially moving that line. isn't the DEP's, you know, function at this point to say, is there enough information? I mean, not to necessarily adjust that line. I mean, the applicant didn't want to adjust the line.
I also don't understand the path that Mike Abel's taking.
I think he tried to, in his mind, see if there was a wetland there or not. I thought that, again, there was enough confusion, especially in that lower area where the moss, you know, closer to the stone wall. And I think, you know, he made this big deal about, you know, is it connected? I think he did see enough evidence that there might be hydric soils, water. Now, the other guy kept saying, oh, well, yeah, there's redox morphological features, but there's beyond 20 inches. Well, the hole he put that in was already mushed up.
Well, and I think that it's beyond the point. He went out to the site. It was confusing. There wasn't enough information to give that line. It should be, in a sense, it's over, right? I mean, there's no more discussion. That line does not have enough. There's not enough information to justify that line.
Well, isn't
not
I
necessarily.
Think
that, it was pretty clear that he got the message. I mean, I think I was pretty clear talking to him. I was like, just jabbering at him the whole time, and he wasn't going to move. I think he's going to do what he's doing now, no matter what, because I said point blank, which is almost sometimes the only way I know how to say things, that I don't think we need a second. I don't think we need a third site visit. You have enough evidence here. I don't understand it. Can you explain it to me? And that's when he said, if he has to go to Superior Court, he wants to be absolutely sure. So he wants to be in the growing season,
which I think is in a sense fine. You know, ultimately,
you are in the growing season.
Yeah. Well, here the definition of the growing season, which was blowing. You know, he was so inconsistent. I almost wanted to ask him his qualifications. But that wouldn't have helped anybody.
No,
no.
So the definition of growing season
is,
you know, biological zero, which is 41 degrees, okay? And we were there.
I think
so. He's talking about we're going to wait for 2 weeks.
And then the root system.
I think there's an aspect of this commission, I think, made a reasonable decision. We don't want to go out there and seem like the unreasonable ones.
So,
what about?
Am I right when I say that if he's talking about Superior Court, he's talking about our bylaw, right?
No.
We denied it under our bylaw, right? And
no, he's not talking about bylaw. He can't. He won't do anything about bylaw.
He can't. That's what I was going
to
say.
So there's two points to this. At the end of the day, anyway,
he's going to Superior Court under our bylaw. No matter what. Right?
Oh, the applicant.
But I think what the gentleman from DEP was saying is, if this has to go to a hearing and it's disputed beyond the DEP's authority, then it goes to court.
I'm going
to
tell you that the DEP, from my experience, does not have any sort of adjudicatory hearing or proceedings when there is a bylaw Superior Court case involved until that case is resolved.
That's okay.
That's what's happened to
but
me.
But that's a separate issue from going to court Woburn. But right?
No, because they wouldn't take it until ours is resolved.
Yeah.
But then they would take it.
But he still has to do his review today.
Yeah.
He has to get by our bylaw in Superior Court. And then he has to get by DEP.
Yeah.
And whether or not DEP takes it to an adjudicatory hearing or not is up to them. And if they want it, he gets passed our bylaw and wins in Superior Court, then he can go argue with the DEP.
But he went to the DEP first, the applicant did, which is his right.
Well, Chuck should mention to the DEP that there's a town bylaw here. And
but he knows
he's going to Superior Court. either way.
DP has blinders on.
He doesn't care.
Yeah.
So why would they make a decision on a case that's unsolved?
Why is he standing
there? Three times they wouldn't do that for me.
Why is he standing there with an auger when what the we denied him because of insufficient information? So we didn't deny a line.
Well,
he's going to go and find a line for us. He's going beyond the scope of what we denied this for, which I don't understand in the first place.
Well, let me ask this.
So you never know what you're going to get when you get to the state. That's the problem.
But so the line moves. I mean, the applicant.
There was a line. An ANRAD submitted.
Ultimately.
And we said no. We voted against it, right?
For not enough information.
But we voted against it regardless.
The line.
And so then the DEP comes, and isn't his decision to say, yeah, there was enough information and that line is correct, or no, there was not enough information, in which case the Conservation Commission's decision stands?
That's my interpretation.
And so on that basis,
he went out today, there wasn't enough information. I mean, he was digging holes. He's trying to find a different line.
So if there's not enough information and we gave the applicant the opportunity to have a third-party review, he declined that.
Doesn't matter.
We're done.
That's my, exactly.
We're done. And
this is what my lawyer says to me all the time now.
You're right, Al. But being right doesn't matter anymore.
So he sent some dates. It was like, I don't know. I should get,
look, going back out there.
I'm gonna go and get the dates off my computer.
Ultimately, going back out there is not gonna hurt anything. It just extends it. And it's just the same scenario as it was today.
What are you guys saying? You're saying that if he goes out there, he's seeing there's a connection, number one. I assume he's going to do some holes, some pits, that you wouldn't accept the DEP's line. Is that what you're saying?
We already did.
He's not going to create a line. So he's either going to say we were reasonable or not. So he's either going to say that the Oxbow line is a valid line and we were wrong to ask for more information.
He didn't say he was going to do a line. He said he's going to adjust the line.
Yeah, and so that's...
Well, what does that mean?
Well,
that sounds like...
That means it's not going to be scientific. It's not going to have anything to do with test pits. He's just going to say, I can see from where I'm standing and vegetation as you go up here, you know? He's just going to move it. He's just going to move it up. He might move it up to that lowest area. He might move it up to where we were talking about. I mean, they're standing on hummocks, you know, digging
right.
a hole, and it came up...
The
it came out hydric, you know?
So if he comes out, let me make sure I get this. If he comes out and changes the line and approves it at DEP, this applicant still has to go to Superior Court?
Yes.
Yeah, that's just the other one
yeah.
I have.
Yep.
So if the town of Reading and the Conservation Commission prevail in Superior Court, then...
It doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter, right? What this guy says.
Doesn't matter what DEP says. We can.
That's what I mean.
There, it's
right.
you know.
That's
it's
what
like
I mean.
It's like the pirate code.
That bylaw is got.
It's only
that's all the teeth. It's the bylaw that has all the teeth, and the threat of the adjudicatory.
The Caribbean.
Those are expensive.
Okay.
All right.
Right. Our motion.
One of the things is he very clearly said that the correct way to base any judgment of the soils is to dig a pit. If he plans on digging pits when he goes out there in the next meeting, who's going to dig the hole?
Yeah.
No, he did those pits.
You
do it with a tile spade. He had that. That's the only... It's not one of those augered pits. It's only... You only go down maximum 24 inches, so you dig a pit. And that's what I hate with the augers. I think there's a lot of mixing crap goes on with those.
Yeah.
My personal opinion.
Well, it's hard to see the soil when you're...
Mush it all together.
When the water's 2 inches below the surface.
Right.
But I think in fairness to him, he's got to be impartial while he's out there digging holes, so...
I make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
I wanna talk about the fish some more.
Do I have a second?
A second.
All those in favor? Meeting adjourned.